Good afternoon, everyone. Could you please take your seats? Hello, my name is Reva Gupta. I'm the Public Affairs Officer at the U.S. Diplomacy Center. Welcome to the screening of Norman Mineta and His Legacy, An American Story. This is actually the final event scheduled at the State Department for APAM, which is Asian Pacific American Heritage Month. With the help of a lot of partners, we have pulled together what proves to be a thought-provoking and very timely film and discussion. I want to give heartfelt thanks to a couple of people and partners in particular. A heartfelt thanks to the Japanese Embassy, the Secretary's Office on Civil Rights, the Bureau of East Asian and Pacific Affairs, and AAFAA, the Asian American Foreign Affairs Association, for helping pull this whole event together. Thank you so much. I think many of us here today share a common experience which will be highlighted in this film. We are proud Americans who believe deeply in America and its ideals, yet we're often not seen as American. I wonder how many of you have been asked while overseas to by your interlocutors to speak to an American officer. And when I say that I am the American officer, they say, no, a real American officer. And I'm like, that's me. But and even here in the United States, how many of you have been told that you speak good English? Or asked you where you really come from? I know that I've had this experience many times. So, and Norman Mineta, he's a very beloved figure in the Asian Pacific American community. His experiences as a child with isolation and incarceration shaped his identity and catalyzed his commitment to public service. As you know, he has served America in many levels, in local government, as a member of Congress, and also as Secretary of Commerce and Transportation during two different administrations under two different political parties. His integrity, resilience, and empathy are values reflected in this film that you will see and that will no doubt inspire you. I too join the crowd of those who are in awe of Norman Mineta and his resilience after having been incarcerated by this nation. And he's not only an example for this nation, but for the world. And this film will help share his story and the story of Japanese Americans, and in fact, it already has, with the generous help of our filmmakers, Dianne Fukami and Debra Nakatomi. Embassies and consulates around the world have done screenings during the month of May. So let me take a moment to introduce you to someone else from another nation who also recognizes the example that Norman Mineta is. Chargé d'Affaires, Kazutoki Aikawa. Chargé Aikawa joined the Japanese Foreign Ministry in 1983 and holds a bachelor's in law from University of Tokyo and an LLM from the Columbia School of Law in New York City. His diplomatic experiences include not only various overseas assignments, but also Japan's permanent mission to the UN in New York. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Chargé Aikawa.
Well, thank you for a very warm introduction. Secretary Mineta, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Japanese Embassy, I'd like to thank United States Diplomacy Center for inviting us at the embassy to be a part of this screening. I'd also like to pay tribute to all the people involved in the making of the film. This is the second time that I see this documentary, and I can tell you this is an excellent film. And as everyone knows, that Secretary Mineta is a leader, a trailblazer in many fields, and a gentleman with a big heart. To those of us at the embassy, he's a figure of great admiration, even to a level of rockstar. When he comes to the embassy events, there is a host of a big crowd around him, rushing to have a chance to talk to him, brief chat with him, and I pay respect. And I must confess, the embassy is an accidental beneficiary of his magnetic personality. Secretary Mineta's story from San Jose, California, to the internment camp in the Heart Mountain, Wyoming, and eventually to the Congress and one of the highest offices in administration is a remarkable American story. And it is also an inspiring story for the people around the world, including Japan. In 2007, Secretary Mineta received the Grand Cordon of the Order of the Rising Sun from then Emperor Akihito for the contribution to the promotion, for his contribution to the promotion of Japan-U.S. friendship. Secretary Mineta always speaks very proudly of his heritage as a Japanese American, and we in Japan are grateful. In fact, we are greatly indebted to Secretary Mineta for the unprecedented level of friendship and partnership that we are enjoying today across the Pacific. Yet, his legacy goes beyond our bilateral relations. His leadership and his strong conviction that what happened to Japanese Americans during World War II should not happen to any group of any ethnicity and any religion is a contribution to the whole humankind. And I hope many people will see the film and come to know the man who has inspired us around the globe. So thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for joining us today. My name is Mary Kane, and I am the director of the United States Diplomacy Center. It is my honor to welcome my friend, former Secretary Norm Mineta, and this film I'm so excited to see and wait till you hear his story. I got to know Secretary Mineta in my previous position as President and CEO of Sister Cities International. As Congressman from San Jose, San Jose was actually one of the first cities in the United States to pair up with a Japanese sister city in Japan, Okayama, which is still going gangbusters today. And that is much to his credit. I'd also like to thank the two filmmakers, Dianne Fukami and Debra Nakatomi, please excuse me, I'm sorry I didn't practice this out loud, for making the long journey from the West Coast to be here with us today. And additionally, the Japanese Embassy in Charge d'Affaires, Ayakawa, for being here with us and co-hosting this important event with us, and for generously donating the wonderful sushi that you will have at the reception following this film. It will also be in the U.S. Diplomacy Center. But I'd also like to thank our partners here in the building, the Secretary's Office on Civil Rights, the Bureau of East Asian and Pacific Affairs, and the Asian American Foreign Affairs Association. The Asian American Foreign Affairs Association has done an amazing job this month, highlighting and celebrating the contributions of Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. We are thrilled to be the culminating event of this month. We organized this event in honor of Asian Pacific American Heritage Month, and we are pleased to highlight the contributions of Asian Americans in the development of this nation. This event is one in a series of public events at the Diplomacy Center this year designed to forge greater partnerships with important stakeholders both inside and outside the State Department community. So we hope you will continue to stay connected with us. And just to give you a little bit background on the U.S. Diplomacy Center, it is the very first museum in the nation dedicated to telling the story of American diplomacy. And that story would not be complete without the voices of all diplomats who helped build this institution and ensured it to reflect the diversity of America. As we will head to the Diplomacy Center after the screening for the reception, I want to share with you what we're doing right now. At the moment, the museum is still in development, but when the full museum opens in 2022, we look forward to offering an inclusive, immersive experience that will demonstrate how American diplomacy has been integral to the prosperity, security, and the success of our nation. And regarding the creation of the museum, we are now in phase two of its development. And during phase one, $50 million was raised to build the beautiful pavilion where the reception will take place. And now in the second phase of the campaign, we need to raise another $35 million to expand the museum by another 20,000 square feet. We have over 8,500 artifacts in our collection, stemming from Benjamin Franklin right up until most recently the history here in the State Department. And one of the things that you get to see are all the secretary's gifts, which are very interesting. Regarding building a more inclusive museum, I would be remiss if I did not take this opportunity to make another request. Although we currently have over 8,500 objects, the presence of artifacts that reflect the diversity of American diplomacy is lacking. So if you think you have any objects that can help us tell a better story, please consider a donation of artifacts to the museum as well. Many members of my staff are here today, so if you are interested, you can discuss potential artifact donations with any of them after the program. And finally, I am honored to introduce you to my friend, again, Secretary Norman Mineta, who will share some initial thoughts before we begin the screening of the film of his life. Please welcome Secretary Mineta.
Well, you can't imagine how surprised and pleased I was to hear that Mary Kane is the director of the Diplomacy Center here and would have this opportunity to introduce me. She and her husband, John, have been great friends for a long period of time. But I really got to know Mary during the time she was the President and CEO of the Sister Cities International Program. And she, with her executive management skills and her ability to deal with people, just elevated the whole Sister Cities program domestically as well as internationally. And so she left the organization in good hands, and now she's here as the director of the Diplomacy Center. Now, this film you're going to see today is the result of some 5 or 6 years of work by Dianne Fukami and Debra Nakatomi. I had been approached on a number of occasions about the possibility of doing a film or doing a book or anything about my life story, and I didn't want to do anything that would be just of a profit nature, and so I always said no. And the other part of it was I didn't want it to appear to be just a pat on the back kind of a program. So with my very good friend Senator Alan Simpson from Wyoming, we have said no to a lot of film issues and book offers. And so finally, after years of badgering me, I think I can use the word badgering, and Dianne kept asking about doing a film, and I said no. And so then she laid out the guideline on how it would be done. And the thing that impressed me at the very top was the fact that I would have no editorial or substantive control of the filming of the program. And that appealed to me. So finally, after a lot of negotiations, I finally said yes to Dianne and Debra. As I said, they've been working at this thing for, I don't know, at least 5 to 6 years. And I cannot think of the hundreds of hours of filming that we've done, and they have reduced it down to this 58-minute program. So I hope you enjoy it. My wife and I and our family have enjoyed this whole experience of going through this. And but they've done a great job, and there's some warts in there about me that I don't like, but that's, you know, part of the whole deal. So again, I hope you enjoy the program. But again, thanks to all of you for taking the time from your own busy schedules to be here to view this program. Thank you very much.
My name is Matthew Asada. I'm the president of the Asian American Foreign Affairs Association, the employee affinity group for all of our Asian American employees and friends and allies here at the department. And it's a great honor to be here today with you. I want to also just recognize a couple others here in the audience. We actually have our executive director for the Japanese American Citizens League, David Inoue, and some colleagues here from the Bureau of the ISN who helped actually tell AAFAA's story and get our word out about what we're doing here at the department to promote diversity and inclusion. And finally, some very special friends of mine, my father, Michael Asada, and my husband, Bilal Qureshi, and his father, Essin Qureshi, were able to join us today as well. So thank you all for coming out. I've had a chance to see this film twice now, once at the museum and for the second time today. And I have to think about the location where we are, here in the Dean Acheson Auditorium at the State Department, a place that's been integral to the conversations on war and peace, Immigration and Naturalization Act, some of the travel policies that we've had here in place. And I want to just ask maybe Norm to start out. What do you see as, how can this film be used to tell the story kind of around the world? And what message does it have for people that are not American?
Well, first of all, the question about how does this story get told is not just this film, but how people live out their own lives in trying to express their own thoughts about the equality of people. And so it is important that people live out their own lives. They can't deny who they are, but I want them to be able to be proud of who they are, not run away from it, whether it's race, gender, whatever it might be, and tell their own story. And that story is so powerful, coming from individuals about themselves. So I hope that this film will also inspire others to speak out on their own behalf.
We were really fortunate here, Dianne and Debra, that you provided the Department of State with the ability to show this film around the world. And we made this offer available to our embassies and our consulates and our American spaces. And we had folks in Vietnam, folks in Cambodia, as well as the Dominican Republic. So places that necessarily don't maybe have anything to do with Japan, with Japanese Americans, but they took something from this story. And I just wanted to maybe ask you, Debra, is that when you thought about the audiences, did you think that it would maybe resonate with some others, you know, in different places?
Well, thank you, Matthew, for the question. I think that we always knew that Norm's story would resonate with American audiences because his story is the embodiment of the American experience of immigration, of racism, social justice and equity, all of the issues that we still continue to grapple with today in this country. But to your point, these are issues that we also see playing out on the world stage. And I think whenever you have an opportunity to reflect on it, and in our case, we're very fortunate that so many of these issues happen to be embodied in one single individual, it really gives us an opportunity to talk about it, to reflect on it. And so much so that as we were thinking about developing this documentary and the content, we realized the richness of Secretary Mineta's life and concurrently developed an educational curriculum, which many of you are aware of. And that curriculum gives us the opportunity to impact generations, not just the people that are watching it on PBS and that can see it today in 2019, but through high school students and through college curriculum, we're able to examine history and the life of Secretary Mineta and immigration, leadership, bipartisanship, and some of the equity issues that are reflected in his life. So we're really hopeful that the film will resonate the same with global audiences, and we're very grateful to you, Matthew, for reaching out, and also to the Asian American Foreign Affairs Association for hosting us today and enabling us to share our story and share Norm's story.
Well, I just want to give you some feedback. It was shown in Kazakhstan at our center in Almaty, and this was from our public affairs officer. The consul general had introduced that event, and he said that the audiences there were unaware of the World War II experience of Japanese Americans and what had happened to citizens in this country. And as Kazakhstan goes through its own change of government, came away with a newfound importance for the strengthening and supporting of civil society and how important civil society was. So I just want to say that, you know, this film is having an impact as part of your legacy, not just here in the United States, but around the world. Secretary Mineta, you had, in the course of your 50-year career, you've taken the oath of office several times. And that's several things that we also here at the State Department have to do when we commission new officers. I'm wondering if you can talk about just what it means when you take that oath of office and the concept of loyalty here to the state.
Probably the most important thing to me is the whole issue of our country being founded on the principles of democracy, of Constitution, and the ability of people to redress their grievances. There aren't very many countries that have that opportunity for their own citizens. And so, to me, that's the embodiment of life in this country, and the Constitution to me is so important. And you know, when I reflect on the fact that when those placards went up, instructions to all those of Japanese ancestry, alien and non-alien, and I'm a 10-year-old kid, and I look at the sign, and I said to my brother, who's 9 years older than me, I said, "Who's a non-alien?" He said, "That's you." I said, "I'm not a non-alien. I'm a citizen." He said, "Well, in this instance, non-alien and citizen sort of mean the same thing." And so that's why to this day I cherish the word citizen, because my own government, the United States government, wasn't willing to use the word citizen to describe me. Now, I don't know how many of you have stood on a chair, beat your chest, and said, "I'm a proud non-alien of the United States of America." I don't think you have. And that's why I cherish the word citizen to this day.
Dianne, in making a movie similar to this, you're faced with creative choices about what to include and what not to include. And I want to ask about an episode that you did not include. What was something that you really kind of wrestled with and said, "Hey, you know, maybe we should or should not," and ultimately it didn't make the cut? What would you do if you were to have a coda to the film?
You know, there's so many things that we wanted to include, so many things left on the floor. As you know, Secretary Mineta played a really key role during the whole 9/11 thing, not just with him advocating and championing Arab Americans and Muslim Americans, but also the way he handled the nation during a very hysterical time, the way he handled air safety. I would have liked to have done more of that, especially because that episode thrust him to a leadership role that was unexpected for him. I mean, that would have been nice. Also, there was a time when he was elected to Congress, and we mentioned it a little bit, you know, he was one of 75 new freshmen elected to Congress. And of those 75 new people, he was asked to lead them in the freshman caucus, a real tribute to his leadership. But on a more personal level, Norm's got a wicked sense of humor, you know? And I wish that I could have found a way to inject that a little bit more. That would have been fun.
When you see recently, this year, it seems to be the year of political documentaries, capturing the rise of new insurgent congressmen and congresswomen, people that are running, you know, for office today. What do you think, if you were to have made a documentary about Secretary Mineta during his first run in Congress, how would that have played out? What would it have been like?
Boy, no one's ever asked us that question before. Well, you know, what Norm did was revolutionary. No Asian American had run for Congress successfully in the mainland. And the background that he had and the experience that he brought too, I think, you know, Riva really summed it up well. All of the experience that he's had and what he has endured and gone through has really helped to form who he is as an individual. And so what I loved about him running for Congress and winning was the fact that here was a guy who really believed in championing the underdog and those who were underserved and didn't have a voice, and that's something he's continued to do all of his career.
For the audience, we do have two microphones here on either side, and we will be taking questions. So if you want to think about your question and approach, and get ready. One question here, Norm, I'd like to ask you just a little bit about, you know, the caucus that you formed, KPAC, and the idea that it seems that whenever at different stages in your life, you saw the value of associations, you saw the value of the organizations and the role that could play. Can you tell us a little bit more about kind of the founding of it and how you see organizations today in the political landscape?
Well, what happened then was that President Clinton had been elected, and Mrs. Clinton formed a health task force. And so I called on behalf of Congresswoman Patsy Mink and Congressman Bob Matsui and said, you know, we'd like to meet with you and talk about health issues that are specific to Asian Pacific Americans. Got no appointment to talk to Mrs. Clinton or to the health task force. And yet the Congressional Black Caucus was meeting with them. Hispanic Caucus was meeting with them. So I came back and I said, hey, we've got to form a caucus. So we formed the Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus. And I called and said, I'm Norm Mineta. I'm calling on behalf of the Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus. Oh, that's great. When can we meet? I thought, wow. So again, you know, just putting something like that together got us a meeting with the health task force. And then I formed another outside organization called the Asian Pacific American Institute for Congressional Studies to be the sort of the research arm of the Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus. So those two have been working together over the years.
Do we have a question here from the audience? And please introduce yourself. Try it again.
Okay, great. Hi, I'm Michael Che Kim. I would join federal service back in end of 2006 at the Department of Commerce, and then went over to state in 2012. Sorry, never got to serve under you, sir. But first of all, thank you. You're one of my heroes, and I never thought I'd see the day I'd be in the same room as one of my heroes, so that's fantastic. And it's interesting, just this Sunday I saw the documentary about the Chinese Exclusion Act, and that's great too. So I'll get to the point. I'm wondering though, especially the past couple of years, you know, we had the shooting, I think in the South, of at a African-American church by a white nationalist. The Southern Poverty Law Center has seen a spike in anti-Semitic attacks, and we've heard a lot about the, you know, our fellow Americans, Jewish Americans, being shot and killed in their synagogues. And it just seems these days, and just at Charlottesville, that poor woman who was killed by a white supremacist, it seems like we're going backwards. It seems like we're becoming more sectarian. And this question is for the whole panel, and especially you, sir, Secretary. You experienced what life was like in the 40s and in the internment camps. Are we going backwards? Are we seeing sectarianism again, or is this a new type of sectarianism that's rising in our country?
Next question. No, that's a very profound, and it's the kind of question that challenges us every day. I think basically there is a certain level of racism in the country, and the question is, are we as a people going to allow that to really set the agenda for what the rest of us, or for what the rest of the country should be saying or acting, or what they ought to be about? And so, and I don't think of us really as a racist country, but it's obvious that's happening, whether it's sexism or genderism, whatever it might be. And so we all have to pick up the banner. Now, I've always maintained that in a free and democratic society, you have everyone from a well-read citizen to someone who runs for political office. But this is only 1% of the population. I want people to pursue their own professional and career goals, and yet at the same time say to the mayor, county executive, governor, to the president, I'd like to serve on a board or a commission for you. And I've always said that anyone can pick up a placard and run up and down the street, get noticed, but the more important thing is to be at the table when decisions are being made about you by people who don't know anything about you. So it is important that you pursue your own career and professional goals. But to volunteer to serve on a board or a commission, and that way you're serving in a public service capacity. And I think that's what everyone should be doing in the nonprofit world, in the business community, wherever they may be, in a governmental agency. Pursue your career goals, but always volunteer to be on a board or a commission where you can be helpful to get your ideas across to other people.
Debra, Dianne, you've taken this film throughout the country and stopping at many different cities. What type of reaction have you received in some of these different places? You know, we talk about, is there a growing kind of, you know, division within this country, or is this film kind of helping to bring people together and have those conversations?
Yes, so we have traveled the film through film festivals and also screening events, and over the past year or so, we've been in San Francisco, we've been in Boston, Texas, Detroit, Illinois. Los Angeles, and will continue to do so moving forward into the future. And there's a couple of points. It's true to the gentleman who asked the question that I think we all, as consumers of media, feel this real sense of concern and fear about the polarization that we see reflected in so much of what we read and what we see. But an experience that we've had with the film, I'd say just over the last 2 or 3 months, has been really enlightening for us. As everyone knows, Norm has spent his career as a Democrat, and he's also been a very strong and capable leader in terms of consensus building and trying to find common ground. And he's known for that, and his reputation often precedes him. And recently, he was invited to speak at the Ronald Reagan Library in Simi Valley. And it was to a group of members, supporters of the Ronald Reagan Foundation and Library, and it was also a group of students. And that was an enormous, in our view, a really important milestone in that he was speaking not just to people who are generally supporters of his career and the work that he's done over the years, but there were new voices that came. And shortly after that, he received an invitation to be a speaker at the Richard Nixon Foundation as a keynote speaker for the 9/11 commemoration. So I think what you see is people are hungry for individuals and voices that will lead some inspiration during this time. And, you know, Norm is someone who really has kind of held the banner trying to find common ground and consensus around issues. So we've been really encouraged by that. And Norm is on the road almost weekly, zigzagging across the country in various speaking engagements. So we've been really fortunate that he's able to speak to all of these organizations. And in a moment, we'll speak a little bit more about the educational curriculum because we have a big plan for that as well.
Would you like to talk a little bit about the educational curriculum and your plans for that?
Well, you know, as a filmmaker, unfortunately, I know that my product has a short shelf life. You know, we're flavor of the month for maybe 3 months, 6 months if we're lucky. But what's more sustainable is getting into the schools and developing curriculum. So what we did was something that's sort of novel. Usually what happens is that once a film is done, it's turned over to a curriculum developer and parts of it are extracted and lesson plans are formed. What we did was we contacted Stanford University before we even shot anything, and we asked them if they would work with us as a team to develop curriculum. And so as we went out to shoot our interviews, they were a part of the pre-production. When we had interviews with President Clinton and President Bush, for instance, a member of the curriculum team was there, and we also posed questions to those two gentlemen that would have nothing to do with the documentary, but everything to do with leadership or inequality, or what does it mean to be an American, which is the title of our curriculum. And because of the funding that we were able to secure, thanks to Norm's good name, all we had to say was, we're doing a documentary about Secretary Norman Mineta, and you know, people would write checks for us. Not quite that easy, but sort of. But anyway, what we were able to do is to secure funding for the curriculum so that we can offer it free online to high school and college students around the country, more to educators. And so what we've done is we've used themes from the documentary, as Debra talked about, leadership, U.S.-Japan relations, that sort of thing. But we've developed each module a little more fully. So for instance, in the social equity segment of the curriculum, we don't talk to Norm specifically. What we've done is we've put together a panel of young African-American college men, and they talk about what it's like to be a young black man in this country. And so, you know, luckily, from the West Coast and also from the East Coast, we're exposed to a lot of diversity, but that's not happening in between the coasts a lot of times. And I think the understanding of the diversity and the personal relationships is what helps people overcome any sort of biases or prejudices that they may have. And so we're hoping by, you know, we can't bring speakers into the classroom, but hopefully through the use of video, we can share personal experiences with people so that we can create more empathy, and different people and different students in the new generation can understand a little bit better about what other people face and what it's like to be walking in someone else's shoes.
Well, I hope that you know, we were able to take the film and use it at some of our American spaces and our embassies and consulates, and perhaps there's a role here also for the curriculum that you're developing, whether it's through some of the schools that the embassies and consulates have partnerships with. There might be a market there. So I know our colleagues here in the Bureau of Education and Cultural Affairs, as well as our new Bureau of Global and Public Affairs, they might be interested in chatting with you more about that. Is there another question here from the audience?
Yeah, hi, sorry. I'm going to take the opportunity to ask one more question. Actually, I'm curious, the question that Matthew, you asked both Debra and Dianne, if, sir, you could answer, are there pieces that you, that were not featured in the film that you had hoped would get featured in the film, or are there things that you kind of wanted to highlight?
Outside of the film, I think one of the problems right now is the nature of the congressional schedule. They come in on a Tuesday at 6:30 for the first vote. They're all day Wednesday, and the last vote is on Thursday at 3 o'clock. But in the last 4 years, they've only met 74 times on a Thursday, so members know to leave early Thursday morning. And they don't get to know each other. They don't even, I don't think, know the subject matters of the committees they're even assigned to. So I think one of the first things that has to be done is to change the nature of the congressional schedule. Speaker O'Neill required us to be, the first vote was Monday at 12 noon, and the last vote was 3 o'clock on Friday. So we were there the whole week. We'd fight in subcommittee, full committee, Rules Committee on the floor of the House, slap each other on the back and say, come on, let's go have a drink, let's go have dinner. And that kind of socializing is not occurring today. They're just not those kinds of friendships and coalitions being built. And so there's some fundamental restructuring that has to be done in the Congress itself to, I think, try to get some semblance of relationships being built among the members themselves. We used to fight a lot, but it wasn't on a partisan basis. It was really on the subject matters that were coming up. But I don't see that relationship taking place today.
Josh?
Thank you, everybody. My name is Joshua Shen. I'm with the Asian American Foreign Affairs Association Board. Thank you, Debra, Dianne, and thank you, Secretary Mineta, for coming here. I really liked at the end where you highlighted, Secretary Mineta, your efforts to build bridges with Japan and building that connection. And I think for Asian Americans, there's a larger narrative that we see in books, film, where there's a struggle between wanting to shout the loudest about your Americanness and still coming to terms with your Asian heritage. And I think for the longest time, it was leaning one direction towards running away or less favorable opinion of the Asian side. And so going back, and I'm also very thankful that the Japanese embassy is here, and we're really happy that you are still continuing to build those bridges. But especially here in the foreign affairs world, where us Asian Americans coming from Chinese, Vietnamese, Cambodian, wherever we're coming from, what is your advice for us Asian Americans in building those bridges and having a voice when we're trying to talk about the Asia Pacific, which, as we know, is of great importance this century in our foreign affairs?
I think there are two parts to that. First of all, we can't run away from who we are. And This other part of it is sort of defensive. I can recall in 1988, when the Japanese economy was just flourishing, and they bought the Empire State Building, they bought Pebble Beach, they bought things across the country. And frankly, there was a great deal of resentment against the Japanese, but it also came upon those of Japanese ancestry here in the United States. So we had at that point, we couldn't run away from our Japanese ancestry, but we also had to try to build that bond between the United States and Japan in another way. And to me, that's what is so important. And I think every country goes through that. Americans of with forebears from different countries. So whether it's North Korea, China, wherever it might be, we can't be all Norwegians coming into the country. Our country has to be open to all those in the future. And so to that extent, I think people, regardless of their ethnic background, have to be proud about being an American, as well as being proud about where their forebears are from, and build that mechanism so that it's both one of a defensive nature in case some attacks occur based on that racial difference, and at the same time being able to positively build on that U.S., whatever other forebear country it might be. And that's why, in a way, I don't believe in the whole idea of a where we're melting pot. I was just having a senior moment, couldn't think of the word melting pot, because in a melting pot you throw everything into the crucible, stir it up, and everything loses its identity. I think of our country as tapestry with yarns, each yarn representing language, art, history, whatever, from some country. That yarn is still beautiful and strong on its own, and yet when it's woven together, it makes for a strong whole. And to me, that's what this country is all about. And I think about it every 4 years at the time of the Olympics, because I know what the team from Germany is going to look like. I know what the team from China is going to look like. But I have a great deal of pride when that team from the United States of America comes in, and you see people with all their talents from an athletic perspective, but they come from wherever their forebears are from. And here they are all marching in as the U.S. Olympic team. And to me, that just reflects on who we are and what we're all about. So I think of our country as tapestry, where each of those yarns are beautiful and strong on their own, but when they're woven together, they make for a very strong whole.
As Secretary Mineta, we really appreciate you coming out here. Debra, Dianne, we're going to have a little bit more time at the reception in the Diplomacy Center. But at this point, I do want to conclude our formal program here in the Dean Acheson Auditorium. And as you talked about those who went before, this auditorium has witnessed several people come and speak, such as civil rights legends like, you know, John Lewis, former colleagues of yours. And we're so honored that you are adding to that history, and that you will, that you've come here to the Acheson, come here to the State Department, and become part of our American story here at State.
Thank you.
Also, on behalf of our team, I want to thank all of you who work at the State Department. You guys work really hard to keep us safe, to try to prevent war. It's a tough time right now.
and we owe you a debt of gratitude. So thank you.